Hello everyone, and welcome to a special in Kerbal Space Program 0.23.5. In this episode, I'm going to explore the possibility of making a single stage to orbit rocket. Not a single stage to orbit space plane, a single stage to orbit rocket around Earth. Now, of course, plenty of people could easily do a single stage to orbit rocket around Kerbin, but Earth is a unique challenge, especially if you're going to use real rockets. And so we've got real engines, we've got these real engines with real stats. And the question is, can we make a single stage to orbit rocket? Now this was due to a viewer request left in the comments, and it was from Andy Black. He requested I make a Saturn single stage to orbit system. McDonnell Douglas, during the whole Apollo program, was looking into how to maybe use parts of the Saturn V rocket. Actually, everybody was trying to figure out how to make use of the Saturn V rocket to do other things. And this is what, I'll start off with what Douglas thought they should do with the Saturn SSTO. They were going to dump the first two stages. So let's do that and hope my computer holds up. Yep, okay, good. And so all this, so let's bring down the third stage and its payload. And you can see this is the version of the Saturn that I used in the 200th video special, which with all the cameras and such, but let's get that stuff out of the way for now. Okay, All right, so here we've got the third stage and its payload, and Let's take a look at the stats for this for a sec. Now, in here we've got the lunar lander and all of that. So let's say we don't need this. In fact, let's say we don't need everything up to and including the service module. You know what? I might want the service module to hang out for a bit. Let's say we don't have this. Let's keep the service module off to the side here. And so now we've got just an empty shell. And what we want is a tapering tank. Let's get rid of this shroud as well. So, a conic tank of some sort. So, the Saturn SSTO was supposed to carry 5 people in an Apollo command module. However, that changed over time. Part of the problem with making the Douglas SA-SSTO was that there are conflicting reports on what it could and could not do. And of course it wasn't actually done, so that adds to the problem. Other reports say that I was using Gemini capsule. So that would be a different thing altogether. Uh-oh. I don't want to do that. But the most reliable numbers I have suggest that it could only carry 2.5 tons. And that's a problem because this command module alone is 4 tons. And that's not including the heat shield at the bottom and the decoupler and the escape system. So we're overweight right now, but let's look into designing this overweight. Okay, and let me design it to the specs that they had first. Maybe we shouldn't have it overweight then. Let's set that off to the side. Let's have one of these command pods. Oh, we can't do that. Okay, well, let's just dump this for now. One of these command pods. All right. Let's just go like this. Okay, now you can see that we've got an overabundance of stuff, but actually this is overweight compared to what they had it. The numbers I have are that the gross liftoff weight was 98 tons. So we've got way more than we should. Let's keep the width the same here, but decrease the length so that we're at 98 tons. And actually, we'll need to put some fuel in this one. So let's go down here. Let's taper this more. Let's get a decoupler in there just for verisimilitude. Ooh. I've got the parts that are so resized. We need to make sure we get the proper decouplers. Ah, there we go. Okay, and why don't we also look into just tossing a launch escape system of some sort on the top. Again, just for looks for now. This is science, not utility. Oh, that's the stock one, which is too big. There we go. Alright, let's just call it that for now. Okay. So. Whoa, why do we have a... Oh, I see. Let's get rid of this. So let's fuel up. Okay. Alright, 98. And let's get to its normal stage length of 6 minutes. Okay, well I can't get quite to 6 minutes for some reason. The game is probably not happy with me right now. Alright, so here we go. And you can see, as far as the vacuum, the delta V is fine. The problem is, of course, this thing can't lift off the ground right now. So, in principle, this could be an SSTO if the engine at the bottom was strong enough. So that's interesting. Now, what other stats did they have? They said they would be able to carry 2,800 kilograms of cargo to a 200 kilometer orbit. They had an engine with 1,230 kilonewtons, which is not too far off from what the J2 does. The J2 has 1,033, I know that from the top of my head. But their engine had 465 ISP, which is the theoretical limit for a liquid hydrogen, liquid oxygen mix. So that's rather convenient that they picked the theoretical limit for the engine. Now, there are a few things you might note. They wanted to recover this single stage two orbit system, so they had landing legs, and okay, so we could probably have enough spare fuel to bring it down safely if we had an engine that was powerful but had the same stats, had the same vacuum stats as this one does. So there's our theory going for us. But there is a problem. They assumed that the engine would act as the heat shield for the return. That's not, to the best of my knowledge, possible in KSP with deadly reentry. So we have that problem. Our empty masses are about right, actually. They had an empty mass of 6,700 kilograms, which was lighter than the Saturn IV-B, the third stage of the Saturn V rocket's empty mass. So, and we're pretty much there, actually, if you add in the rocket weight. So this is okay, except we've got a one-person pod instead of a three-person, but let's go with this for now. So we need an engine that's more powerful, and we'll talk about heat shielding later. Let's first try and get into orbit, and this isn't going into orbit. I guess I'll dump this now. I was gonna use it for another demonstration later on, but... Okay, we'll hold off on that. Oh, my computer is trying to be frozen. Okay. Alright, so, let's look for another engine. And let's put a little bit closer to the 2.8 tons that they planned for. Let's have a... Well, we don't want to mess up the heat shielding. But let's put some sort of reaction control system. Let's just put the stock one. No, that's too small. Okay. Alright, we'll go with that. Now, what kind of engines could we have? Let's just pull out the ones that could possibly work. This, so we're looking for something with an engine ISP of, let's say, above 440, but also its sea level ISP has to be above 300. And so this is just a J2X, which is an uprated J2, and that's not going to work because it doesn't have enough ISP. Yeah, let's just say that. We need to find something with reasonable liftoff ISP as well. And so we see all these happy little real engines. Well, that's close. Let's say the RS-68A, which is the core and booster of the Delta IV vehicle. Okay. The Russian stuff. It's just this. The one used in the Energia. I think. Is there another one? That's no good on the sea level. Yeah, it's just the Energia one. The Merlin 1D is kerosene liquid oxygen, so it can't compete with a H2 liquid hydrogen rocket. So, as far as doing this particular thing, however, it's got other benefits. It's got a high thrust to weight ratio. So, just going through, and you can see the stats of all the engines I have at my disposal. That doesn't necessarily mean it'd be the engines that they have in their disposal when they were designed. This, the Vulcane looks interesting. It's not 440, but yeah, let's... And you'll see all of the rockets that we are picking out are liquid hydrogen, liquid oxygen, because that's the only way you can get such a high ISP. Oh, those are the stock ones. Okay. The liquid fuel aerospike does have a nice profile to it, but it does not have the high vacuum number. Okay, we don't need four of them, but these are the space shuttle main engines, and we'll just pick out one of them. You notice the space shuttle main engine is more powerful than we need, so is the Energia core, I think. Yeah, a little bit more. The rest are about in the right range. The estimate was 1,230 kilonewtons of thrust. Obviously, nuclear thermal would be great if we could get it off the ground. These are just different variations on the rockets we already have out, I think. Or, yeah, the Delta IV rocket. And that does it. So that's all we really have to work with. So these are the possible engines. Let's get rid of the J2. We don't need to refuel this too much when testing this out. This one barely gets off the ground. It has pretty decent delta V here. But you gotta notice another problem that we have. They were trying to build a crewed vehicle. But the thrust to weight ratio at the peak here is really dangerous. 13 at the top end. That's quite a lot of G's that you're going to be pulling at that point. And this engine doesn't throttle. If it could throttle, we could limit the number of G's that they're pulling when the engine is about to burn out. But this is going to produce 13 G's. This one is really powerful. It's going to produce 21 Gs, and its delta V is not very good. But then we could also increase the size of this whole thing. The reason it's got a lot of problems, if we take a look, is now it's throttleable, so that's a good thing. But it also has a huge mass, 10 tons. So if we put it on, you can see it goes up 10 tons, or just thereabouts. And here, this one is about 3.3 tons. So that's why this one has such a problem with the vacuum delta V, the delta V on altogether. But it has a huge thrust to weight ratio. It's also way overpowered. The Energia, good liftoff, still 16. Does it throttle? That's now our question, whether these things can throttle the light past it. Yes, it does. So it can throttle, so we don't have to worry about the thrust-to-weight ratio as much. We would have to make this a little bit bigger to get it to the right delta V. So that's a possibility, though I'm currently hesitant about using Russian engines, you know, and weapons, engines. Okay, so this is the space shuttle main engine, and as you can see, it also would produce a very, very high thrust to weight ratio at the end. Its throttling goes down to 66% or so. So we're still talking about 10 Gs at the end. It's not quite there on the delta V, so we'd have to make this bigger. Unfortunately, the engine that looks closest is actually the Energia. The problem with the Vulcane is that it doesn't throttle. So we'll be facing high Gs, and we've got all the realism mods in, so those high Gs could probably kill a Kerbal. So we're gonna have a Kerbal in. It is a very odd looking rocket now. So we've tried to keep it about the dimensions of the third stage of the Saturn V, but really, as the Wikipedia page on the Douglas SSTO noted, that's sort of a conceit on their part. They were saying that they were going to make it like that, you know, use the third stage of the Saturn V, but really, really, they were going to do a lot of things to it to change it anyway. So while we're at it, let's keep the mass the same. Let's keep it under 100 tons, but let's change the diameter of this so it looks a little bit prettier. Let's say we're going to go for a 4-meter diameter. Which should fit the rockets. Let me just check that it fits the... Yeah. The Vulcane that I'm going to use. But it'll fit that one. So if we really want to use the rockets as heat shielding, that's our best bet. There's no way we can... But now we do have to keep it actually stouter than this. Because if we're going to land it, the taller it is, the harder it is going to be to land it safely. So actually let's go to 5 meters. We want it a little bit stout so that we can land it properly. If that's something we end up doing. Okay. And so we need this a little bit bigger. That's a little bit actually... Wow, we're really getting to the point where we might as well be going fatter even. How much is that? Let's go to 0.25. Okay, well that's pretty good, except that our delta V is a little bit short. I guess we'll go over 100. Let's get it approximate. So I'm just gonna size it to get up there this time, and we'll test it out. And we'll see a single stage to orbit system for the first time. And we'll have to throttle this down. So we'll keep in mind that the Vulcane is a thing. The RS-27, is it? No, 68A, sorry. 68A, the 25 are all possibilities. This is an external... Okay, now this has an external igniter, and as far as I can tell, the only way I can get those ignited is with this little launch clamp. Go figure, right? So we'll use that. And we will have an umbilical tower. We will have standard personnel Loading tower. It's looking all very official. We gotta sneak a little decoupler in. Not that little. Okie dokie. Set up the abort. Okay, so this would be an SSTO, however, and this will be as close as we could get to the stats that they had for the Saturn SSTO. One thing I didn't do though, which might help, is reload the fuels, because they were actually configured for the J2 and not the new engines. So maybe that'll make a difference. Ah, see, look, the reloading the fuels meant that it also got heavier, but also we have a lot more delta V. So maybe we have a chance to use one of our own little rockets. Ooh. Set that aside for a bit. The Delta 4 one is a little bit heavy. I don't like that. Let's go with the usual supposition is that people were thinking of using the Space Shuttle main engine anyway. So let me go with the Space Shuttle main engine. The thrust weight ratio is a little bit troubling, but we do have the rest of the stats to work with. It gets off the ground a little bit too fast. I think we do need it a little bit bigger. To slow it. Though we could add some the landing rockets. Let's see. What could we use as landing rockets? We should probably use rockets that really, the liquid hydrogen, liquid oxygen mix would be good for those rockets. So what we're going to do is we're going to... Yeah, let's pick the rockets first. They need to be some sort of hypergolic combination. Maybe just a hypergolic rocket will do. Is there a sufficiently powerful one here? We don't have much of a choice though. I don't have many radial engines. Well, we could put it at the base here. Assuming that re-entry doesn't heat the whole thing up like it should. MMHN204? Too big. Well, if we're gonna go Apollo, ooh, they fit. That's sort of a surprise. Yeah, they fit. Okay, we're gonna use 4 Apollo descent engines. That's fair enough. So what we need to do is remove all tanks. Oh, this is gonna be complicated. Well, at least it's 50-50, so that's not too bad. So we just add the same amount of aerosene in N204. Okay, so now we've got 9,516 delta V on the Space Shuttle main engine, and we've got about 22 seconds worth of fuel on the descent engines. Don't really have any sort of landing leg that's long enough to handle this, though. Gotta say, wrong category. Well, let's get rid of this thing. Well, those are close, but they don't retract, unfortunately. Yeah, I'll keep them off to the side, though. They're probably the best bet. mean, you can see how small these things are. I guess we'll have to have something extending from here. Too far. Okay, something like that. Wow, those mini struts are really, really hefty, aren't they? They brought our delta V down quite a lot. I think we're just gonna have to, well, I mean, we're gonna have to extend this stage anyway because the sea level thrust is a little bit high. So we're going to just up this stage. And we'll keep doing that as long as we have to. We might need to just broaden it too. These aren't fitting right now. Okay, so let's go broader. We might end up at the same size as the S4B anyway. We'll find out. But we're gonna do it slowly. And you might wonder why I don't just use the space shuttle main engine for the descent. And that's because of the throttle, right? Because I can't throttle it down enough to slow it down. The descent engine, as you can see, has a minimum thrust of 5, which is good enough. That'll help. And so I can throttle it down sufficiently so that I don't have to worry too much about that. But the space shuttle main engine will just take off again and we'll go off into God knows where. Okay, now so we have extendable things. And we need to put some sort of lander legs on it. These don't look very... I mean, they'll work, maybe, but they'll probably tip over. Maybe we can find something with a little bit of a broader base. Perhaps the stock ones will be okay. Ooh, getting into the KSB interstellar parts. Did I miss it? Must have. There it is. Ooh, they're tiny. Very cute. How do they look? Doesn't look like it really hold, does it? Well, considering we're probably not going to get past re-entry anyway, let's think about that. We will want to have our Kerbal be able to get back. Let's put a little service module with some RCS on him. This was supposed to be designed for a little bit more mass than we're giving it anyway. I'll just put the stock thrusters and parachutes. Whew. Well, all right. That's that. Now we need some way to control the return the stage. And we will want to bring this back, by the way. You can see how expensive it is. Very expensive, these space shuttle main engines. Not a great choice of remote guidance units. And I say that because, well, I mean, I guess this is the best one. Very heavy, though. Yeah. On the bright side, all the mass should be at the bottom by the time we need to worry about the balance of it. Probably some batteries would be useful, though the battery power on that will be fine. We just need something in line, I guess. Every little thing adds to our mass, and we get to do that now. So, have I forgotten anything? Probably solar panels will be helpful. So as you can see, their estimate of 2.8 tons of cargo was probably wildly optimistic. Even with the, the spatial domain engine is about the best engine. I mean, we could go with that Russian one, but those two engines, either one of them would have probably required a much bigger rocket just to get this payload up. So a 99-ton rocket to get a 2.8-ton payload, single stage, is probably quite overly optimistic. And a lot of the details of what they were planning seemed overly optimistic. They probably didn't address the G-forces, and their contention that the engine can provide heat shielding seems optimistic. But of course, I'm not a rocket engineer, but, you know, sometimes even they get a little bit overly optimistic about their estimates. Okay. I think we're ready to go. Let's try it out. Let's get into orbit. I don't know if we're going to be able to retrieve it. Oh, we need antennae to control us. That's gotta be interesting too, because we'll have to try and land it close to the KSC, otherwise I'm not gonna be able to have control. I don't have a satellite in orbit in this save. Okay, I think that's everything all set. So let's call this I have to call it the SA-SSTO because this is not the only Douglas SSTO. There's also the Delta Clipper, the DCX. For some reason, McDonnell Douglas really liked the idea of single-stage two-orbit systems, so this is not the only one they designed. Alright, let's take it out to launch pad with, I guess we'll have Jeb, yes? Alright, let's go. So here we are, a very highly modified version of the original intended Saturn SSTO. Oh, I missed one of the launch clamps. Well, it seems to be balancing fine right now. Well, actually hanging. Swaying a little bit. But it sort of looks the part of Saturn SSTO, at least. And it is certainly going to be a single stage to orbit. Let us try this out. Throttle up. Jeb looks ready to go. We're at 151 tons, delivering really very little to orbit. And so that's... Why does it look like there's a gap between things? You can sort of see sky here. I don't like that. But, let's see what happens. That seems like an interesting little glitch there. It's possibly... I can't imagine why. That's the... This is the... Well, there are solar panels, but this is the reaction wheel, and this is the remote guidance unit and the battery bank, so why should there be a gap between them? These are all fairly standard parts. Alright, well, I'm not gonna be able to figure it out. Okay, yes, good. Light, and go. Okay, let me get full gimbaling on this. I've got a tweakable gimbal on, and we'll need it. Okay. And this will be our single stage. I guess we can bring the escape system down here. There should definitely be some really inspiring music here, but I'm not going there right now, but we've got Jeb, we've got a fairly unique rocket system here, and this is something of an adventure. Now, obviously, if the space shuttle main engine could throttle down fully, or, you know, to a very small idle, then we could just have used it for the landing engine.
For one of us, you're fine. There's no risk. Yeah,
though there are other issues. For instance, we would need to relight the rocket, and we would also need to make sure that the hydrogen and oxygen were settled in the tank. And that's a little bit hard because the vehicle would be we've got some dynamic pressure here. Would be descending, right? So the fuel would be really trying to get to the top of the tank rather than the bottom of the tank. So it'd be pretty hard to settle those fuels and feed them properly. We've got some wiggles here. Might be that the gimbling is too much for SAS. That can happen. Gonna have to keep an eye on G-forces as we go up. One good thing about this is it's a pretty short flight up. When you've only got one stage, it tends to be pretty quick to get to orbit. It's a very Kerbal experience to get to orbit in around the Earth using a single stage. Though, okay, I think I should tone down the gimbling on this, not the descent engine. Though the descent engine I should probably give a little bit more gimbling to. Yeah. And that should be mirrored. Generally, SAS can deal with 3 degrees and, like, nothing more. Oh, it isn't mirrored. Wow. That's gonna be a pain. Okay, well, I'll have to fix that in a sec. Let me get this to the right attitude. Okay. So, this one, 3. Fuel flow unpressurized. Oh darn. This needed a service module. Oh, okay. So we won't be able to bring it back this time. Yeah. The aerosene in N204 needs a service module tank to contain the fuel. Forgot about that. So no safe landing for this one. Though we could re-enter. We can try re-entry. No, we can't. We wouldn't be able to deorbit it. Or it depends on whether we can relight this engine. We could pretty much go flat now, can't we? Alright, let's get rid of the escape system. Right? Now remember, because we want to get this back down to around Cape Canaveral, let's say, just for communication if for no other reason, we can't get it to partial orbit and just bring it down straight. We do need to relight and do all that and deorbit in a more complicated manner. And, you know, it's single stage to orbit, so it has to actually get into orbit. Otherwise, it doesn't count, right? Getting pretty dangerous on the G-forces again. I mean, Jeb looks copacetic, but he is experiencing 8 Gs right now. So, this is pretty intense. So it's a bit hard to keep the Oh. We're actually short of orbit. Okay. Well, we're not going to be able to come back down anyway. I don't think we can light the Erosene rocket. So, we're short of orbit because it was getting a little bit... I didn't have the right launch profile is what that happened. But, you can see that we could have gotten into orbit. That's not the problem. What we need is for him to be... Oh no! Unfortunately, the service module is covering... I forgot to put a decoupler in the middle of... So, actually, let's get Jeb into orbit. And if we try to deorbit him right now, this is actually a little bit too steep for this pod to do. The G-forces will probably kill him. Okay, well, this is looking pretty bad for Jeb. But fortunately for him... As I was saying, fortunately for him, this is a special. And I don't have any compunction about reverting in this case. Let's try this again and get the fact that we need a pressurized tank for the Erosene 204 correct. And the decoupler as well. Okay, so before I do anything else, let's fix the technical problem that we had here. Okay. Let's see our situation now. Oh, as expected, a little bit dismal. Now, it's tough to say how we could heat shield this properly. I mean, it's not really feasible to have the front end be a heat shield or anything like that and just go in front first. That's not going to work because all the mass is in the tail anyway. So one way or another, the tail has to be shielded. But then what about these landing struts, right? They got to be sticking out no matter what you do. And they were sort of on the side, similar to the Falcon 9 one on the Douglas SA-SSTO design. So a little bit shielded, much better than we've got here. I don't have too much of a choice because I need to extend the landing struts below the engine, and that requires this sort of thing. But yeah, it's tough to say how the heat shielding really would have worked. Alright, let's save this. I think I've made the fixes I needed to. Probably don't need to have that there. And I guess we can stage this here somewhere. Oops. Okay. So, let's have Jeb try this one more time. Yeah. Let's try this again. Why does this look weird? Ah, alright. Let's go. You know, whenever I get out to launchpad, it changes the numbers on me. This is a different number than I had before. But, well, what can I do about that? I don't know. Need to be able to relight them. I mean, how am I going to deorbit this thing after all? It'll be tricky. Well, this time I'm going to use Smart ASS's surface feature to do my thing, and hopefully we'll get into a much better launch profile then. Okay, let's go.
Hello,
We got a little bit less arrows in an N204 than we had before. Considering the state of delta V of this stage now, maybe I should up that a bit. Lots of wiggliness. It doesn't really like to stay quite where I set it. I definitely don't want it pointing up like this. No, get back down. There seems to be some aerodynamic instability. It's not settling down. It's oscillating like this. Still doing this pointy uppy thing. Oh no, come on. I'm now grabbing the control stick and forcing it. Okay, gotta take Smart ASS off actually. I'll just control it myself, as horrible as that is. So this time I'm just gonna follow my prograde vector down to, for the most part. I think we can get rid of the escape system now. Going to go, it's not really two-thirds throttle, it's about 86% throttle, as we want to limit G-forces here. And I think I'm gonna go flat as well. This is, following the prograde vector down is not a good idea with this. It's just got too much acceleration, it can keep the prograde vector pretty much wherever it's pointing. Again, we're facing the problem that I had before. The orbit is not where I want it to be. Still gonna fall short. Okay, I mean, this is really a matter of getting the launch profile right, and for this rocket, it seems like I need to flatten out way earlier than I do. Way earlier. Let's try this again. Let's revert to launch. So I've been trying a very Saturn-ish launch profile up to now, but that's definitely not appropriate for this rocket. So let's try and flatten out a lot sooner than I normally would around Earth. Yep, let's go. Problem is, we're gonna face a little bit of heating at this point as we go really fast through some atmosphere here. Actually, even more than apoapsis, time to apoapsis is something to look at. You can see it's still going up quite a lot. I think that was a new Chatterer clip, I don't know. I don't remember hearing that one before. This is way earlier than I'd normally go level, but seems like it's appropriate for this rocket.
Please help me,
that you need. Oh yeah, the use of cell amorphous nickel zero through wave.
Still, trying to contain this thing's enthusiasm for a high apoapsis is very difficult, and... I mean, honestly, without risking pretty bad re-entry heat, I don't know how I will be able to do anything with this. Well, we need to get into orbit. Let's wait until apoapsis and then burn our aerozine rockets for a little bit to finish this thing off. How much will we need? So let's try and get some sort of a... Yeah, that'll be good. 118. We've got 340. So just for the retro burn, we need 118. No, not retro burn. What am I saying? It's not a retro burn at all. It's actually a orbital burn. It's still the same stage. No bits have fallen off, right? So there's that. But getting the launch profile for this thing right is going to be a lot of trouble. It's very different from any other rocket I've launched around with the real Earth.
434,
nice sound on these rockets. Okay, and that's what we'll have. Alright, now what we need to do is wait until we're... Well, maybe we should do like SpaceX did and try and get it at a hover above the ocean instead of at Cape Canaveral itself. You know, because we're testing, right? Anyway, let's get it around first before trying to decide. Oh, we gotta hit the atmosphere so we can't time warp. The atmosphere shouldn't bring us down at 111. It shouldn't be a big deal, but let me orient retrograde just in case. We definitely don't want to bring Jeb down with us. He's pretty heavy right now, probably about 2 tons, and the whole vessel is only 16. But we need him along for now, because otherwise we can't control this thing. Oh, speaking of which... in the dark, but we need to access this antenna and have it target mission control. Kennedy Space Center, active. Okay, this is gonna be a long time before we can get anywhere, so I'll catch up with you once we are... I'll catch up with you once we're further along. Okay, I've plotted descent, but we're gonna have to decouple from Jeb before we do it. Because we don't want to bring him down too. Now, I don't know, I think Jeb, as long as we maintain communication with Jeb, Jeb can control this. So we're going to be using the Reflectron RP10 to control it for the retro burn. Actually, you know what, we probably shouldn't be doing the retro burn, we shouldn't be lined up like this. We want to release Jeb and then turn to the maneuver node. Otherwise it's going to be a problem. Otherwise we'll run right into Jeb. Okay. So let's try this out. We're going to decouple Jeb, if I can see things right. Hopefully we've got staging right. Yeah, I think so. So we've got to decouple Jeb, hope that we can maintain communication, and then deal with this. Okay. Nope, looks like connection is not a thing with this stage. I think maybe Jeb's pod doesn't have enough connectivity. Let's see. Maybe I should have put a bigger antenna on Jeb. Where are you, Jeb? No, he's got a 50,000 kilometers, really? Wow. 50,000 kilometer range. Can he not control... I guess just one guy can't control something like this? I haven't really tried this sort of thing out before. 1,000 kilometers. Charge is fine. We've got plenty of electric charge here. Huh. Yep, I guess this is not a way to... Well, we'll have to wait until we're over mission control then. Okay, accidental time warping brought me a little bit past the mission control, but let's do the deorbit burn. I don't anticipate being able to make a controlled landing with this time. I'm going to have to forego that pleasure if I can actually get some control over this thing. And that's the reason I can't make a controlled landing is because I just don't have the communication satellites up to control this, and we would need it. Need some way to communicate with it opposite, well, fairly distant from mission control where I'm doing the retro burn. And since we don't have those comsats, I can't make a controlled landing. However, we can test whether the idea that the engines can provide heat shielding would work out. So let's do that. Alright, so a retro burn. And we're gonna have a pretty serious descent, I think. Because I want to bring it down over... I think that should be good enough. Yeah. I want to make sure that it's going to be coming down... I don't know, that might not be enough. On the daylit side. Yeah, I don't think that'll get us... So it's gonna experience much more re-entry heat than it should. But that's fair for a serious test anyway. Okay, now I think it will... Well, it's pretty high, the apoapsis, you see. But I think it'll manage to be still on the sunlit side. This part will shorten up. Actually, since we're going to be not making a soft landing, let's make sure we don't hit Africa. Let's make sure we're in the Atlantic. I hope that's good enough. Okay. And remember, with the Falcon 9, it wasn't descending from orbit. It was only descending from 80 kilometers. The first stage only burns for about 2 minutes. 2.5 minutes, and then descends. So re-entry heat is not as big of an issue. It's trivial compared to what this thing is going to face. And this thing is probably going to face more than the real Douglas SSTO would have, because I'm going with a steep descent. And that could cause other problems. We'll see. We'll see how this works out. Gonna lose communication soon. There we are. And it will have to right itself. going tail first. Okay, looking good at least for pointing in the right direction. Let's reduce time warp so that things aren't getting too crazy. And now, I guess we'll just keep an eye on the temperature of this tank. Seems like a more appropriate thing to do. Of course, we want the engines to survive. Those are the expensive parts. The tank, we could lose the tank. But no chance of the engine surviving if the tank doesn't. Getting pretty hot down there. Got oscillations, as you can see, but of course that's because there's no control. Getting very hot now. 200 degrees Celsius. How's the tank? Because of its rocking motion, it's probably dissipating heat. Yeah, it seems to be. Now, the landing legs, that's a different story. You can see the mini cubic truss, well, the antenna was gonna go anyway. No, the RD, that's probably because of the rocking motion. This LM descent engine is gonna go. Ooh, that was a nice one. Okay. So the descent engines are not good for this sort of thing. Actually, the RS-25D seems to be holding up pretty well, isn't it? That's interesting. The mini cubic trusses are doing better than I thought. The cryogenic tank is safe, apparently. But I think we've lost our landing legs and our landing engines. Those will have to be placed somewhere else, I think. But this is encouraging. Or I was about to say it was encouraging. What happened there? G-force tolerance. Well, actually, that's because of our steep descent. If we had a much more gentle descent, the G-force tolerance issue wouldn't be a problem. So aerodynamic stresses and G-force tolerance is mainly because I had to make, well, I chose to make that inadvisable descent. The position of our landing struts and descent engines is definitely a problem. They burned up in a phase of re-entry where it makes me think that they probably wouldn't survive even a gentle re-entry. So that's a problem. Interesting to me that the aerocam also burned up. Maybe not having that on, it might absorb too much heat and then conduct the heat to the other parts. Not too sure about that though. So anyway, you can see the situation. Actually, G-force is, I mean, 10.5 really? Oh well. Okay, so yeah. So we've got some challenges. I'm not going to try and fix this in this special. You see that it is possible to get a single stage to orbit rocket going. I don't know if it's the best idea. It's not very efficient. If you could bring it back down safely, that would be an interesting trick and definitely a video I would want to watch. Given it being around Earth, right? But otherwise, I don't think it's something I want to play around with too much more. It's not a very efficient way to do things, and more trouble than it's worth, honestly. If we could control the vessel separately, in other words, like Falcon 9, if we could have the second stage and the payload continue on to orbit as planned, and then control the landing of the first stage, That would be something interesting. If we could control, if we could have the payload continue on to orbit and then land this separately, that would be fine. That would be a much better way to go. But of course, we've got the physics limitations of the Unity engine and Kerbal Space Program to deal with, so we can't quite do that. So that's about the sum total of it. So the Douglas SSTO, very optimistic, I think, in its estimations. Doable given the space shuttle main engine or an equivalent engine, and quite a lot of fun actually. Certainly much quicker to orbit than any other system. So anyway, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below, and I'll see you next time.